Broadcasting from stages 2 and 4 in Burbank, California, let's go inside Salem on NBC's Days of Our Lives podcast.
On today's podcast, after dying on the show multiple times, Jack Deveraux is back. Matt Ashford sits down to talk about his jaw-dropping return. Then, in two can't-miss clips, Gabby's lies blow up in her face, and Jennifer desperately urges Jack to remember their storied past. Later, we have an exclusive interview with Rob Scott Wilson and Victoria Konefal to talk all things sin. That and more, starting now. Welcome to the podcast. I'm Michael Fairman. Days of Our Lives fans have been ecstatic since the news that Matt Ashford was returning to the series as the beloved Jack Deveraux. And as was revealed on the New Year's Eve episode, Jennifer and the town of Salem are stunned when Jack walks into a party very much alive. After all, everyone believed he had died this time via death in an elevator shaft. How he comes back to town is shocking in that Jennifer's arch nemesis, Eve Donovan, returns to Salem too and has a guy in her clutches, and he has amnesia to boot. To tell us about that and coming home to the NBC soap opera, please welcome Matt Ashford. Hi, Matt.
Hi, Michael. How are you?
How are you?
I'm feeling pretty good.
Yeah?
Yeah.
You have been killed off and let go from the show how many times?
You know, it's hard to say.
It's hard to say,
right? It's hard to say.
Because you were always the guy that I never understood why they were letting you go, because you were so original in this role and so loved. So it just, every time there was like, what's going on, you know?
I think so. I mean, what's interesting is that that's kind of become the character, this coming and going and couldn't staying and everything like that. And I think we're kind of working on finding out about that a little more. What kind of a guy is he that comes and goes and, you know.
Do you remember what happened each time he was killed off?
Kind of.
I'm trying to.
Well, I mean, the big one. Well, he got the shaft. That was the big one, you know. And kind of the first one was going. You know, he had so messed up with his own daughter Abigail, and he caused this poisoning of this water, and his own daughter actually got sick from it. And I think just things was like this loathing. He just had to leave. He couldn't. You know, and so he ran away from it. And at the time, I was like, you know, I was like going, dang, like, what does it say about a person who can run away and leave your very young child who's kind of sick and disappear, you know? But that's kind of what he was. And so that was the big one, the first time I left. And then after that, there was these series of comings and like almost dead or not quite dead, and this thing about, oh, getting hit over the head with a brick, I think.
Oh, there was the brick. Yeah.
Yeah. But I, you know, I always look back and I said, you know, he never really died. You know, in the same way that I guess Stefano never really died. I don't know. I mean, it's kind of confusing around here. So, but if I have to have that conversation with someone where they say, how many times did you die? I go, well, I've lost that. I've lost it already.
Lost it already.
I know, because like, why are we talking about this? Let's just talk about the living, you know. But it's a function of these shows. And, I like to think that he's dynamic and he causes trouble just by being there. And sometimes maybe it's just the character was just too troublesome to live in that town for a time, you know. So, I mean, you know, I can justify a lot of things.
How was it knowing that Jack would not remember his old life, you know, and the fans that rooted for Jack and Jennifer for so long to be back together don't get their wish at this point? Are you at all concerned about how the viewers will feel about the storyline?
I'm not sure. I mean, of course, coming in, I didn't realize that the character of Will had gone through something similar.
Yes.
So for me, it's all the first time. It's me. What about me?
Amnesia runs through the town.
Yeah, it does. It's in the water. Oh,
amnesia,
no.
Runs through the town.
Yes. Well, for me, it's opened up a lot of opportunities in what's coming that couldn't have been there before. Things that have happened going on between, you know, with the characters of Jennifer and the character of Jack, and then obviously the character of Eve. And I remembered years ago, I said, Jack was married to Eve, wasn't he? And I realized, you know, they've really worked very hard to dig deep and find out all sorts of juicy details that have really enriched the story on Days of Our Lives. So I think it was a very good move.
Do you think Eve is a legitimate challenge for Jennifer, ultimately for Jack's heart?
based on what's happening? Well, I'll have to say yes, in that she, neither Cassie nor myself had any idea where the story was going to go and what it was going to turn into and what we'd be able to bring to it. So Eve, in terms of Jack's heart, he doesn't know his heart. But he's a blank slate, and she brings things to the table that Jennifer doesn't bring. And it may be some of the things that people most dislike about her end up becoming a good thing. I mean, does that sound like a bit of a conundrum, which is exactly what it is. And it's what we're finding. I mean, I think we're finding out things in the playing of it. We're finding more that's there, and I think they're very happy with that.
Do you think Jack's PTSD will be something involved in why he has the amnesia? Because there was a big PTSD storyline for him before, too, from when he was tortured.
Yes, he was. But at this point, he doesn't remember.
He doesn't remember being tortured.
Which is, I mean, there's all these really interesting things to play with, because where does memory exist? I mean, is it in my brain or is it deep down inside me? So,
I think one of the best weddings of all time was Jack and Jennifer's at Universal Studios when you guys had your wedding. Mm-hmm. And do you agree with that? I mean, I know you couldn't see, the sun was in your eyes when you were doing the vows, but to me, I could still watch those clips and go right back there. And I think they're just beautiful and great. And you guys made that couple so engaging and believable. And
well, thank you. Thank you for that. I mean, I was in it. My preparations for it was learning to ride a horse. Or not learning to ride a horse, but at least learning how not just to get thrown off the horse. And that was, I mean, I was enjoying that. And then this crazy, we all had these kind of strange adventures, grincing. And then Missy got strapped into holding onto this pole and doing this, you know, the original pole dance, I guess. Yeah. I mean, it was crazy what she was doing. And so there was a lot of mayhem.
But then when they actually got to the vows, that's what was so great.
Well, yeah. But, you know, Missy did all the talking.
You did a little bit.
I did a little bit. But she made a, you know, there was a vow that she made that really kind of went viral before viral.
Yeah.
People were using that or are using that.
It was thou shalt now rain. I just remember there was.
See, there's things I'm talking about the weather. There was some weather reporting.
There was a weather report in the vows.
You know.
Will you be able to interject the humor, the style, the wit of Jack in this amnesiac version of him? Because that's what everyone loves to see you do, because I just think that's so.
Well, we shall see. This is another thing about memory. Just like you don't have it. If you had a sense of humor before, do you have a sense of humor? And I don't know. That's the kind of fun stuff I get to play with. Like, what is inherently in you? Who are you? If you have no memories, then are you no one? You know. And this is what we get to kind of play with a little bit, because Eve gets to rebuild. Because I'm kind of wide open.
So are we going to pull our hair out in the audience just waiting for him to have his memory back? And it's just going to go on and on and on, and we're going to be banging our heads again, like, when will he remember?
Well, I think there's a lot of crazy twists and turns that I never saw coming. And that's this writing. It's the things are just, there's just lickety-split things happening. And it was the first time I'd ever really sat down and experienced. I started looking through the script, and I kind of couldn't stop turning the pages. I went, wow, what's that? What's he? And then I was into someone else's scene, but I saw how that scene fit into my scene. All these interesting things. But there's so much more happening than just his memory. But without having your memory, suddenly other possibilities arise that you kind of went, well, that's crazy. Can we really do that? I guess we're doing it, you know? So,
we'll see. So 2019 is going to be a big year for Jack Devereaux.
Yes.
And Days of Our Lives. Days and we can't wait to see how it all unfolds now know you're finally on screen.
Yes.
And we can't say much more than that or we'll ruin the rest of it. So,
well, I mean, I was hearing about old storylines that were just kind of blowing my mind with, you know, Jennifer and
Eric.
Well, Jennifer and Eric, yes. But I didn't realize that my own son, you know, Cassie, you know, at one point they said, you know, the two of us were an item, you know, for a while. And
what about that?
What about that? That is dealt with And then, but then there's the other thing. They told me about Jennifer walking into the bedroom or the hotel,
seeing her son
in bed.
Does he react to this?
Does Jack? Matt was reacting to it. I was going, you got to tell me what happened. What happened? I had to go to each one of them. Then I got to Casey and I said, Casey, what happened? And then he said, she jumped on top of Eve and started to strangle her. And then I said, okay, Casey, but what were you doing? Where were you? He said, I got out of the bed.
It was quite the affair.
Yeah, well, they had quite the affair, even JJ. Yeah, I know.
And then Missy Reeves got an Emmy nomination for all of that, for that showdown scene.
Oh, my gosh. Well, just hearing about it, and then I said, poor Casey must be, JJ must be damaged. I'm like, my mother came in and, really.
And I imagine it'll be sad for JJ, too. He's always had this relationship with his father that never really, because his father hadn't been there for them, and now his father's back, and his father doesn't even remember him.
Yeah, it's odd. And it pushes him into places that he hasn't been, right? And Abigail, we had some things. I was like, man, this is intense. All these intense women.
So are you going to watch your Arrival when it airs?
Yeah. Well, it's on. It's downstairs, so we can see it. Yeah. I'll see it. Yeah, and I'm really enjoying the way these things are playing and seeing what people are doing. There's some really fine actors on this show, and some of them are pretty young. One of the great things that's happening is we're really getting to work with other people of different groupings and ages, and everyone doesn't stay within their strata, and you get to really enjoy playing with people, and they're really fun and funny, and they're enjoyable off screen as well as on.
All right, Matt, well, here's to a great 2019.
Here.
And we can't wait to see what happens with Jack.
Oh my gosh.
And I know, yes. I'm going to want his memory to come back, maybe.
I think there's memory plus. He's making new memories now.
That's right. Like those memories?
I don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't know. There's a parts of them. I think they're going to like some of them.
Stay with us for some Can't Miss Clips. Here's your Can't Miss Clip for the week of December 24th. Gabby convinces a heartbroken Chad to move in with her and Ariana. While she starts to pack, Abigail reveals to Chad that baby Charlotte is his daughter. Unconvinced, Chad believes Stefan changed the result, but Abigail clarifies that was at the hands of Gabby Hernandez. Gabby attempts to explain her way out of the accusations, but Abigail punches her. Chad won't accept Gabby's justifications, and together with Abigail, they demand to know the truth. Take a listen.
I never, never wanted Chad to suffer. I was going to tell him the truth about Charlotte today.
Yeah? Well, since you're suddenly all about the truth, Gabby, why stop now? Let me help you. You drugged me, you slapped that stupid wig on my head, you dragged me to Stefan's, and you lied that I assaulted you. And the entire time, you pretended that you were my friend.
Really, Gabby?
I wasn't sick, Chad. My DID wasn't back, it was her.
I don't know who the hell you are. I don't know if we were ever friends, but if we are, I'm begging you. Gabby, please tell me the truth.
Yeah. I did it. I did all of that.
Well, that's not a nice thing to do. Very upset.
My goodness.
I mean... That was the moment where Gabby finally gets her comeuppance and she's cornered and she has to admit the horrific thing she's done. Putting a wig on Abigail, making her think she has dissociative identity disorder, getting her committed to a sanitarium, switching the DNA results. Wouldn't Jack punch out Gabby?
She was just this sweet little girl when I left. She was.
And Gabby was?
Well, yeah, I think so, yes. Oh, yeah. And things changed. Things change. Yeah.
I want him to go clock her.
Clock her. Wow. Yeah. he's not a woman hitting person. He's not anybody hitting person generally, but I think, even in observing this, I almost think like she's going to feel better after she's let that one out. Carrying that stuff around, what good does it do you after a while? She had so many schemes going on. I think it's actually kind of opens it up.
Opens it up.
Yeah. But they, and in its own way, they helped her let that go. If they're going to be friends after this or whatever the relationship, we'll see. But letting that stuff out is you know, it's the best thing that could be for this person.
And we can all move on as fans with the show and finally move forward.
Yeah, absolutely. Here's your can't-miss clip for the week of December 31st. New Year's Eve kicks off with the return of Eve Donovan, who teases a giant wrecking ball headed to Salem. Eve takes shots at Eric, Chloe, Brady, JJ, and then zeroes in on Jennifer, pegging her for Nicole's death. Eve's mystery date arrives and is no other than Jack Deveraux. The reunion is short-lived when Jack doesn't remember his family. Jennifer urges him to come home to reconnect. He refuses. Here's what happens next.
Oh, I see what's going on here. You turned Jack against me.
She did nothing of the kind. The facts spoke for themselves.
Oh, yeah, Jack. Well, the facts, they don't tell the whole story. They don't tell how the story started, how we fell in love, how you took a college intern under your wing and made her a journalist. You gave me a career. You taught me how to dig for the truth, and that is what you need to do right now. You need to dig for the truth, Jack. Because you can look at me, and you can see the woman that I am, the girl that I was, the woman I grew into. I did that all with you, Jack. I would never be the woman I am today without you, Jack Deveraux. You taught me so much. This is crazy, but one time you gave me this little jade plant and you said it was so vulnerable, yet so strong, and you said that was me, that I was like that, and you taught me how to not take life so seriously. And that I could overcome anything. That we could overcome anything together, Jack. I have always loved you, Jack Deveraux. And I know somewhere deep down inside, I know you feel the same way.
No, I don't.
I'm so upset. That's terrible. How did Missy do that monologue? Where did she do it in one, like...
We had to get through it without laughing. She started
not
bringing
you.
It up.
No, I'm so surprised.
Learning those lines and imagining this scene, I had the giggles for quite a while. I had to get past
the plant.
Yes, the plant. She could bring up the jade plant. We had so many laughs about that. Jade plants are very tough. You know, it takes a lot to kill them.
They brought up the jade plant, yeah.
I know, and I mean, I've since that time I've realized, oh, there's like this whole metaphor to this plant, because I see them now. But when doing this, we had to do this, and she had to look me in the eye and do this. You know, I started remembering, they said, whoa, as we were kind of there, you know, the director, producer said, you can't laugh. Not you can't laugh. No, I got past the laughing. We both laughed. We all laughed. She's like, hit me with both barrels there. And like, how could you not react to that? But they said, you don't, because this isn't a person, you don't know this person.
Will we learn why he has amnesia?
I think we will.
Okay.
I think so.
Okay.
If I can remember that. Yes. Yeah, so but it's very, I'm just saying, even watching that, it was very intense. But, you know, this show is really an intense show, because I was like hearing it from backstage all this time going like, I'm going to make this entrance. Like, and it's just, everyone was so great. They were so focused and, I mean, giving 100%. You know, Wally and Judy were, I mean,
it's
this
a dramatic
is family.
Doozy.
Well, yeah, there were people there I know. Yeah. I know these people and they know me, but I don't know them. So it was kind of wonderful. And it's like, it's your birthday, but you're not ready for it to be your birthday. And everybody shows up with the cake and the candles and you're just kind of sitting there in your underwear or something. I don't know. But you're not ready.
This scene was such a special scene for the show. It was extra in length, and it had a big gravitas to it, and they really set up you walking in and then the reveal of he doesn't know his family, he doesn't know Jennifer, He doesn't know what's going on. Yeah. Did you know what's going
to happen? Well, sometimes we have used to do long scenes. And,
back
in the day. And it comes and it goes, but it hasn't been the rhythm and the pattern of the show for a while. So to give it this weight is really kind of powerful because they were going. They were going and they were on this ride. All of them were on this ride. And they said when they rehearsed it, when they did it, that everyone on the set was kind of remarking like how great. They said there was nobody saying, please keep it down, please get quiet, please no cross-talking or anything like that. Everyone was incredibly supportive of, you know, because so much of it, Cassie was having to do, Cassie was carrying this thing. And then Missy had to pick it up. And it was just so much. But you know, these other people, Judy, Wally, you know, they know what it's like to kind of be in this situation. So it was a very supportive.
Did you feel like the weight also, like I'm making my entrance now? Yes. After that had yes. to be on your mind, like
yes, I was like, what if I don't? I can't just say I don't remember. You know, right. That will only work once. Right. Because I have to have more words. But it's, you know, a big scene is a big scene, and nobody wants to drop the ball.
All right, Matt, well, here's to a great 2019.
Here, here, here.
Be sure to catch Jack's return and stream full episodes of Days of Our Lives on NBC.com and the NBC app.
Part 2 of Inside Salem Days of Our Lives podcast will return in a moment. Subscribe to the show wherever you find your podcasts. Watch full episodes of Days of Our Lives and listen to an episode of this podcast early every other Friday on the NBC app. We now return to Inside Salem, Days of Our Lives podcast, to take a look behind the scenes.
How do you reform a serial killer hailing from the Ozarks and pair him with the beautiful daughter of the Commissioner of Police of Salem and make it a smoldering romance? That's what Days has been serving up in the burgeoning love story of Ben and Ciara. To say this duo has captivated the audience is an understatement. With their active fan following of #sinners and the amount of obstacles thrown their way to even go on a date, they couldn't even book a table at Doug's place, viewers eagerly tune in to see how they find ways to be together. So how do my next guests make the connection happen on screen? Well, let's find out. Please welcome back to the podcast, Rob Scott Wilson, and making her first appearance, Victoria Konefal.
Yeah.
Hello, hello.
So let's get into this. Tell me about how you both go about preparing to take the stage or the set to perform your scenes on camera. Do you rehearse a lot together in your dressing rooms? Like, what is the preparation to make Sin come to life?
We definitely rehearse a lot. We like to get the lines out of the way so that we can focus on the emotion and connecting to the work and the creativity. And we love to work with our on-set acting coach, Maria. She's amazing. We work with her every single day.
But do you guys run a lot of lines together?
Yeah, I mean, we try to. I mean, no matter what, we'll always get it in, you know, as much as we can. Due to, like, time parameters here, obviously, we can't always, you know, work it as much as we'd like. This morning, we just got f***ed out of the We didn't even know one of the things we did this morning was tape, but
I thought,
you know,
we were
they
rehearsing.
Loved it. So,
And they went
straight to tape. Yeah. And I thought it was rehearsal, and I was acting as if it was rehearsal, not knowing. Like, I started saying la 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 in Rob's ear.
She finished my line and turned her cheek to me, which I'm still feeling.
We were supposed to kiss, and I gave him the cheek because I thought it was rehearsal. And
so you do the real kiss in rehearsal?
No.
You do the real kiss on tape.
Yeah, yes. And it's just everything about it. Like, I was reaching up my arm for a hair tie. Like, I just wasn't real. I didn't realize that we were taping, so.
But it was interesting. They loved it.
Yeah.
So it worked.
It worked.
It worked. They said it worked, so it worked. I trust them.
What do you think is the key to actors making a successful on-screen romance come to life? What have you learned in your time on the soaps?
To play into the friendship aspect of whatever's going on. I think that, you know, Rob and I are really great friends, and that helps a lot. But, I mean, with Ciara and Ben, it's a lot about forgiveness and trust and just instilling that in the audience's minds when they're watching to be able to see a serial killer as a reformed man.
Yeah, I mean, we both had our work cut out for us, I guess, walking into it. But to start it off, like, not forcing a romance or not trying to be this, like, suave, romantic lover type and just be, try to be as honest as you can. And it's like,
yeah,
if you know your character, you know, we know our role, you know, she knows Ciara very well. And I know, I know Ben better than I probably know myself, so I can make probably better choices for him than I can in my own life. But I think it kind of just fed into it fed into the dynamic with each other because they're both just damaged people. And yeah.
Which I love about it. Romance is clumsy. It's not always this gorgeous way that romance happens. You know, you've seen in a Harlequin romance. And so right. in this, it's kind of interesting to see how they positioned it. When you see the audience response to the two of you, and you see that reaction, what do you think of how they're responding to you? You've got the hashtag sinners out there everybody on board. And what do you think when you, at the end of the day, when you see how it's taking off?
I am just, I don't know. I'm grateful. I'm grateful for the fans. They're the reason why I get to wake up and do what I love every day. So I'm thankful for them in the first place for watching the show. In terms of how much support we get, I'm over the moon. Like I really didn't expect this much. I really didn't expect them to be so loyal, but you know, they're Days fans, so of course they're going to be loyal.
Yeah, I mean, the best compliment is when people who don't watch the show or people who are watching other soaps just see this like fire burning somewhere and they're like, change a channel for the first time in 20 years from channel 2 to NBC, you know, is probably the best compliment because they're a hard group to break and everybody has their show, you know, my grandmother, my mother, they all had whichever show they watched and for them to like jump ship literally for our ship is pretty f-ing cool.
I asked some fans to send me some of their burning questions this morning on Twitter.
Yeah, I realized because my phone was blowing
up.
Thank you for that.
You're welcome.
I had to turn off my phone notifications.
I'm sorry. Okay, but I got some questions for you. From them. So Team Ciara and hashtag Ben asks, what love song would you describe Ciara and Ben's relationship? Sing the song.
I took it last time, so you pick. And don't pick the same one that I picked.
Ooh, well, challenge.
We did the one that we did together though, right?
Yeah.
I had another one, but I don't know
Say
if everybody.
It.
What is
it's
that?
It's a Bob Seger song. It's called Fire Down Below.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you know that?
I just remember like one of the opening lines because it's so ratty, so good. Comes old Rosa, looking mighty fine. It comes about, but no. Hang on, I got a better one, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh my
he's
god,
just really, he's really tired. Bob Seger, The Fire Down Below, because it's I like it. There's a few songs that work for them, but that one at a period of time, I remember it, and I was like, this is good, cool, edgy love, but like fiery, fun song.
So let's see when we put this podcast out if they like Fire Down Below for you guys. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a
They've got some amazing choices, probably better choices than
I've got. They're amazing.
They've made some pretty cool stuff.
Wise13183 asks, which character do you think will be the first to keep an open mind to Sin's relationship and maybe bold enough to be the champion for them?
it's really Ben and Sarah versus everybody, especially right now what's going on. But if
Ben and Sarah against the world for now, I mean,
isn't that what people love to see in romance? Yeah,
that's the whole point. Is you're fighting for the underdog. But it's you're rooting for the ones that you don't expect to be together.
Maybe the waitress in the Horton Town Square or something, you know.
The waitress in
the diner.
Yeah.
Somebody who just sees us who don't really know us that well.
Yeah.
And they just see us.
Oh, you know what? Claire.
Claire.
Claire totally wants us together
because she wants trip, remember?
Yeah. So I guess she's the one.
Yeah.
Claire and the waitress in the Horton
Town
Square.
Claire and the waitress in the Horton Town Square will be rooting for Ben and Ciara. So Sweet D asks, we've been dealing with the fire storyline for 6 months now. Is there any hope in sight to it ending in 2019?
No.
No.
So you guys must be like,
New fire down below. I'm telling you, the song rings bells. I'm telling you, it speaks volume for Days of Our Lives right now. If y'all are in a fire, we got your juice.
Russell Savala asks, what do your parents think of the Sin storyline?
My dad, every time he calls me, he's like, stay away from that psychopath. And I'm like, trust me, I'm trying. Dad doesn't like Ben Weston.
Dad's
Mom
not happy.
Loves Ben Weston.
The ladies.
Mom always knows.
Yeah.
Mom's down for
mom,
this?
Yeah, no. Ben Weston was always kind of my mom's type when she was younger. Like, she loved the leather jacket guy and the guy in the boots. And, you know, like, my mom dated a motorcycle rider at some point. So, like, she's pretty badass. And she's attracted to the
devilish kind of guy.
Yeah. I love mom.
Yeah.
That mom. So what about your parents?
They love it now more than ever, mainly because I think their friends and their family are like, wow, he can like do the side that we saw him go nuts with, and now he's playing this, and it's just such a contrast, and I'm just happy to see them happy. They get they get excited about everything.
Which I love. I saw you in the hallway and you were on the cover of Digest. You're like, I got to send this to my mom.
Yeah.
I thought that was so
my
great.
My mom loves all that. She'll go on the, you know, she'll take, you know, and I think my dad too, they'll take the copies and like move them up front. And like take the rest.
My mom didn't get a copy, and I didn't get one either.
We got to get some copies.
We got to get some copies.
We got to get some copies.
Okay, we'll get that. And the last question is a deep one. It's from Ben and Girl. When home in Massachusetts, which do you prefer, Rob? Dunkin' Donuts or Starbucks?
Dunkin' Donuts.
So you're in the Dunkin', not the.
Yeah, I mean, don't get me wrong. I'm just a coffee fanatic. I really am. But it's the first thing I do as soon as I get my JetBlue terminal. I don't care if I land at 4 o'clock in the morning. I'm gonna go grab like a coffee from Dunkin'.
See, no. I was hoping you were gonna say you were gonna have the donuts,
but I know you don't eat a donut.
Yeah, right.
He eats donuts all the time. Are you kidding?
I smash donuts.
You do not.
Hulk smash donuts.
True story.
I'm shocked.
What do you mean? I'm a donut fanatic. Yeah, cupcake fanatic, pie fanatic.
Sweets, right? There's a continued rocky road ahead as we go into 2019, and I know what we're going to see is there's some fights between the two of them, and Ciara,
Ben and Ciara.
Yes, Ciara's not happy that he's working for Stefan.
Oh, right.
Can we talk a little bit about that, or should we be worried that this is like combustible?
I think that Ciara is just at this point she loves him, so she's very concerned for his well-being, and him getting mixed up with someone dangerous is not her ideal version of how the way their lives should be going at this point. People are having a hard enough time in this town to accept him as a good guy to begin with. So the fact that he'd be working with one of Salem's most hated men and one of Salem's most dangerous men puts Ciara in a weird position also, because she doesn't want Ben to do something that he's going to regret one day, or that will potentially spark the mental breakdown that he had in the cabin or any of his past issues.
But here's the problem. Where is a guy like Ben going to go even get a job? So you
right,
kind of
that's
feel
the whole issue.
It really was upsetting.
It's quite difficult. I know.
Because I feel bad for Ben too. Like he's going to have, what's he going to do?
Yeah.
He's like, you wanted him to get you.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. Ciara wanted him to get a job.
I mean, he couldn't even get a job as a dishwasher.
Yeah. And Julie wouldn't even let you have a date in the restaurant. Like, where are you
going to
go?
Those are some of my favorite scenes, by the way.
That's a little bit tough for Ciara to swallow the entire situation, because like she has to give him the benefit of the doubt because of the fact that he can't get a job anywhere else. He has no choice. He has to
It's quite a sticky situation.
Yeah. It'll be a test, and we will see what happens.
What's Ben's position?
I know it's going to cause some drama with between him and Ciara, because I know it's going to put me in some predicaments where I'm going to have to make some choices on how dark he'll go still being this reformed man. But I think me selfishly as an actor and for Ben overall and the writers, I love the dynamic between him and Stefan. And I think it was just awesome. But I don't know. I enjoy playing both sides of it. So I'm grateful they wrote it, but I know it's going to cause some turmoil between Ben and Ciara. So you guys will see how it all plays out, because you know love wins.
Love wins. 2019, also at the beginning, Ciara is got problems with her mother. I mean, her mother, Hope, is endlessly determined to bust up her relationship. Is it going to be the end of her relationship with her own mother over Ben?
I don't think that Ciara and Hope will ever end their relationship. I think that they may have their issues, but it's only because they're both really strong women and they butt heads.
Could you see her ever accepting him?
No, not as of right now.
Well, let's take a listen to a big moment in 2018 for all Sin fans when Ben and Ciara finally shared their first kiss.
I told you once before, never apologize for who you are. You are the bravest, strongest person I have ever met in my life. When I found you on the road that day, your leg was shattered.
But your heart
was whole.
No. Your spirit.
I thought I had.
We're whole.
I know this.
Whole spirit. This is my favorite part.
Celebrate you have more fight in you than
a bag full of bobcats.
Did you actually just say that?
I'm sorry. Did I just say that? I'm sorry. It's an Ozark.
Oh, band. That's not in here. You ad-libbed.
Yeah, through the Ozark. Yeah,
that's
if you're too broken to love or be loved.
I had to make it honest.
What does that mean for someone like me?
I'm sorry, I didn't...
No, no, it's all right. Because as messed up as I am, I know there are far crazier people than me who do find love. So I'm not giving up hope.
So you're ooey about it?
I cringe when I watch myself anyway.
Yeah.
And I've been, like, the last couple of days have
been cringing?
Emmy submissions. Emmy submissions. So I've been watching this scene.
So in the scene, the kissing scene, the big moment, you drop.
I do. I drop my helmet. And fun fact, that was improvised. Yes, we had to add a shot for that after I actually dropped it because they didn't have the cameras pointed at it. And I heard Janet going, oh, I love that. Let's go again. Let's go again. And they repositioned the cameras so that we could get the moment.
That's awesome. When you were getting ready to shoot the scene and you knew that the fans were waiting for them to kiss, was there a lot of weight to the scene for you? Like, were you worried, like, it's so important to the story and the fans have been waiting to see that, that it was at all intimidating to you?
I don't even know if the stuff started to air yet. Or like
the
first stuff, but we carry weight with us when we first started this whole thing. We just did the work, you know, and I mean, that wouldn't have changed, I don't think, regardless. But knowing now, it definitely adds more fuel to the fire because we know there's just this, I've used the word army before because they're so like vicious. They're just really passionate fans and they're awesome.
Now, Rob, can you be my acting coach and give me some pointers on how to inhabit Ben as I attempt to read this now famous
to inhabit Ben.
Victoria. First, I got to talk
a couple packs of Marlboros and a bottle of whiskey before we get there. But we gotta
so
get
whiskey
you there.
First.
Yeah,
okay.
Put yourself in a place of whiskey
drop
and
your
some
voice.
Deep.
Drop my voice.
Okay, now we just now all of a sudden you sound like you're from Brooklyn.
Yeah,
I don't know if that.
Boston.
I don't know if it's that.
Forget about it.
I don't know.
Okay, wait. We gotta get Boston.
No, I think we just gotta settle you in. Let's settle you in.
Settle me in.
Take your time.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Take your time. Take a breath.
Here we go. Kid. Yeah, here we go. All right.
Get the f*** out of here. Do I sound like that?
No, right. I can't
get
do your voice.
Get the f*** out of here. Do I sound like that?
There's a little bit. No, he's got a Boston, but it's not really bought. Like,
I'm sorry. I don't think I can do this. Oh, that's the first line. You thought that I was saying that.
You believed it. Okay.
Look at me, Ciara.
I can't do this.
Look at me.
I'm starting to think that I can't do this with anyone. That I'm too broken and I'm too damaged to love and to be loved.
I told you once before, never apologize for who you are.
Take a breath, Michael.
You're the bravest, strongest person that I've ever met in my life. When I found you on the road that day, your leg was shattered, but your heart, your spirit was whole. Ciara Brady, you have more fight in you than a bag full of bobcats.
Did you really just say that?
Yeah. And then I improvised the line.
Oh, God.
Oh, did I really just say, sorry, that's the old Ozark boy in me coming out. But seriously, if you're too broken to love or be loved, what does that mean for someone like me?
I'm sorry, I didn't know.
No. It's all right. Because as messed up as I am, I know there are far crazier people than me who do find love. So I'm not giving up hope, and you can't either. I won't let you wipe that tear from your face, honey.
Why?
Now let's kiss.
I'm going to start by saying, Mr. Ron Carlovati, I apologize for what he just did to this.
Oi.
I've destroyed your performance.
I think I need to actually pull my clip from that now. And,
I wouldn't get the part.
I think you gave.
I want that character in something else because I do like it.
Yeah, you gave me a lot to react off of. You know, there was a lot. It wasn't the colors that I was expecting. It wasn't, you know.
You didn't like my dynamic, okay?
But
it wasn't the sin dynamic. But you know, it was a good one.
I tried.
That was.
But that just shows you. This all goes to show.
Yeah.
How good he is.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much. That's all my point.
Sure.
I'll take that. Thank you, brother. That was awesome.
Yeah.
That was awesome.
Humiliating. Thank you. Victoria, Rob, thank you. So much fun, always.
Thanks, man.
Chatting with you. And best to you in the new year.
Thank you. Thank you, guys.
Happy New Year.
Come
Coming up on Days of Our Lives, Xander has some inside intel to get back in Victor's good graces.
Where'd you get this?
Does it matter?
Of course it matters.
What matters is I have it, and you want it.
JJ walks into Gabby and calls her out for her lies.
Oh, what you did was horrible. But you didn't just do it to my sister. You did it to me.
Maggie questions Brady's involvement with Chloe.
You and Chloe have a bad history.
It was years ago. It was a long time ago.
Days of Our Lives. Stream anytime on NBC.com and the NBC app.
This has been Inside Salem, Days of Our Lives podcast. Subscribe on all major podcasting platforms. Do you want to hear the show early? Every other Friday, the show will be available on the NBC app. Follow the show at NBC Days. Theme music by Tom Boyce and Bobby Hart. Produced by Grant Rutter and Michael Fairman. Edited by Trey Booty. This is Melissa Reeves. Join us again for another episode of Inside Salem, Days of Our Lives podcast.